So last year in 2017, Atlus teased during the Persona Live Superbomb concert that they are working on three different spin-off titles for the Persona series. Since then, Japan has received two of those games, being Persona 3 Dancing Moon Knight and Persona 5 Dancing Star Knight, but the third game in that trio hasn't had any new information released on it. Until today! After almost an entire year of radio silence, Atlus has announced that Persona Q2 will be releasing on the Nintendo 3DS on November 29th, 2018 in Japan. So let's talk about it. Despite only being a minute long, I have watched this trailer about 100 times. So there's a lot I want to talk about with this specific release. I'm a big fan of the first Persona Q, and it's crazy that we're even getting a sequel, let alone on 3DS. But let's jump in and see if we can find some finer details about the gameplay. So the first thing I want to talk about right now is this character right here. What the crud is happening? What? Currently, we don't know the names of these two characters, but if we could make logical assumptions, safe to bet that they're the Zen and Rei of PQ2. And by that, I mean they are more or less the focal point of the story. While all the Persona characters coming together and interacting is kind of the main appeal of the Persona games, at the end of the day, it's probably going to be a story about these two characters. Let's talk about it. I like how they look. Well, one of them at least. The first character, who's the girl, she's cute, you know, I like her. She has a little film roll attached to her hat, got a little ribbon bow on her sailor uniform, white hair, red eyes. Is that like a, I don't know, I'm getting like a Alice in Wonderland sort of feel from her? Don't know, but they went with that theme for the last game, so I doubt they're gonna do it again. And they have this weird shadow, disgusting, he looks like the uncle you don't want to see at Thanksgiving. I don't like him. He's scary and weird, but interesting to say the least. I like your tie. That's kind of all he's wearing. But seeing as the girl's always doing the rectangle thing with her hands in the trailer, and she's also holding like a director's speaker, so to speak, even though it's kind of like old fashioned, I guess she's the kind of reason they're going into the labyrinth, they're going into the movies in the first place. We don't know. I hope we get a little bit more information maybe in the next week's Famitsu about this character, because I like her character design and it's really mysterious, and that excites me a lot, because Zen and Rei definitely were not. They just kind of looked like they were Persona 4 characters thrown into Persona 3. But let's cut all the bullcrap. No one cares about the original characters, John. Moving on. So Persona Q2 will feature not only the cast of Persona 3 and Persona 4, but also the cast of Persona 5. That is almost 30 plus characters in your goddamn game. However, it does seem the highlight is mostly on the Phantom Thieves of Heart. Who would have thunk it? That makes sense to me. I'm just happy we get to see the cast of the other games interact with all the others. Some people were worried you were only going to be able to play as the protagonist of the prior games, but as we can see here in the trailer, that they have Yukari, and also Teddy shows up like 1,000 different times as a, almost to say, "Hey guys, remember when I was the mascot?" Not to make the most obvious joke of all time, but legit everyone is here, and that is amazing. It makes me kind of wonder though if they're going to give past characters in the series access to the new elements introduced in Persona 5, such as the nuclear element, since that wasn't a thing in past games. And does this also mean that there are going to be three separate campaigns or just the one for the Persona 5 party? Hopefully it's the latter, because honestly, ain't no way I'm gonna play that game three times given how hard the last one was, but I guess we'll just have to wait and see. The next thing I sort of wanted to analyze is that during this gameplay segment, you will notice that Narukami, the main character, and Yukari's portraits are all different. So does that mean we're getting redesigned artwork for all of the characters? That's kind of crazy. That's 30 characters. So it seems like they're going the extra mile, at least with this game. Also, during this gameplay segment, we can see that the Persona 3 and Persona 4 interpretations of Shadows have returned instead of the Persona 5 Cognitive Demons, which I'm honestly not a fan of, but it makes sense given that they're going with a chibi style, and the Persona 3 and Persona 4 games did have a super deformed art style during combat. But outside of that, there's not a lot of goddamn stuff in this trailer. You can also see Akechi right here during what appears to be the opening segment, so rest assured, Akechi fans, he's gonna be in the game, as if there had to be any doubt. But I guess is apparently in this robot army. I don't know what that's about. It appears that the first level is going to be a Jurassic Park parody where the shadows are dinosaurs. That's kind of odd, but I guess it makes sense with FOEs and whatnot. But all I care about is seeing Yuno Akami fight Joker. And how are you going to stop a sword with a handgun? God dang, dude. That's my favorite part of the whole trailer. And at the very end of the trailer, Atlus drops the biggest goddamn bomb for fans. The Femme C, or female protagonist from Persona 3, will be making an appearance in Persona Q2 to some extent, and god dang, the fan base is going crazy! Often disregarded as not being canon, and often forgotten, the Femme C is back! And yeah, people are pretty excited about it, myself included. I thought for the longest time that Atlus just did not want to really associate themselves with this character. She was designed at a point where Atlus was still kind of growing and understanding what they wanted to do with the Persona brand, and maybe they just wanted people to forget about her. But she's back, baby! And yeah, that's pretty darn cool, but a little bit confusing for reasons we'll get into a little bit later. But so Akechi's in the game, Femsi's in the game, god dang, that is a lot of characters, almost 30. How are they going to handle this? I got no idea, but you know I'm going to play it anyways. But with that being pretty much the end of the analysis portion of this video, let's just talk about this game and some of my hopes for this new game. Things I think they're going to bring back from Persona Q, things I hope they don't bring back from Persona Q, and just pretty much what's on my mind when I watch this trailer. So obviously, Akechi being in it, Femsi, super awesome. However, I am kind of scared, guys. Atlus is trying to put 30 characters, almost 10 years of video games, into one game. How are they gonna do that? How are they gonna manage that, dude? One of the biggest complaints, at least here in, you know, the international market, is that Persona Q ruined some of the characters. Some characters like Chie and Akihiko basically being one-joke characters that you have to tolerate for 45 hours of gameplay, and some characters like Teddy basically not being existent. So naturally, some fans are cautiously optimistic. However, I'm blindly optimistic, and I think that, personally, I think the best way to do this would be to just primarily focus on the Persona 5 characters and have the Persona 4 and 3 characters kind of just show up as, you know, companions, not really focus so much on the interactions between them all at once. 30 characters talking at the same time might get kind of crazy, I'm just saying. But next I kind of want to focus on the gameplay of PQ2. I hate to burst your bubble. If you think this is not going to be a dungeon crawler, keep dreaming, okay? So the Q in Persona Q actually comes from the Japanese name for the Etrian Odyssey series, which is another Atlus-produced RPG series that I really want to talk about, and might as well be a Persona skin for an Etrian Odyssey game, because the gameplay is more or less similar. Sure, you can't really fuse Persona in Etrian Odyssey, but the general idea here is that you're going to be, you know, crawling through dungeons, drawing your maps of the dungeons, and then fighting FOEs. And hey, I like Etrian Odyssey, so I'm pumped, but a lot of people don't. And that is gonna be an issue, I think, for some people. They might think, oh man, I don't like this from Persona Q1. Maybe it'll be different in the sequel. I don't think this game is gonna be that different, okay? So, if you are 100% convinced this game is going to be different, somehow it is going to be a 3D platformer, go for it, keep believing that. But it's going to be a dungeon crawler, alright? And that does bring up a couple issues I had with the previous game in the series, so let's not beat around the bush. Some of the later dungeon designs for that game were just bad. Like, I love Atlus games a lot. I talk about them, but even for Etrian Odyssey standards, specifically the fourth dungeon in Persona Q1, god dang, what were they thinking? Confusing and just honestly not fun to play. The fifth dungeon kind of made up for it in my eyes, but goddamn, I hope they do tone back the difficulty a little bit, or at least make some of the puzzles not nearly as arcane to understand. It seems that sometimes with their 2D dungeon crawlers, Atlus is like, alright, we're gonna spam a lot of enemies right here and make this puzzle really difficult. Wait, is that fair and balanced, sir? Eh, they'll figure it out. And we kind of just put up with it as fans. I don't know, that's just how I interpret it. Is that the case? You tell me. But I'm sure they'll figure something out. With sequel games, developers usually have a better idea of how players generally respond to the tasks that their games contain, and maybe they'll dial it down a little bit and put more fun stuff in, like when you could marry whatever character you want, and I got married to Margaret.
And that started to hold a lot of problems in my... anyway.
Next thing I want to talk about is how exactly is Akechi going to work in Persona Q2? Because I don't think I need to put a spoiler mark up, but he ain't the nicest guy, all right? And also, if we awaken our personas similar to how we did in Persona Q1, everyone's gonna be like, wow, Goro, your persona is really, really evil looking. So that's probably gonna be a little weird, but outside of that, the next thing I wanted to talk about was the FemC's inclusion once again, because it is really confusing. It makes sense for her to show up in this game, because XD, it's a dream world, whatever happens, who cares? And it seems like that's the kind of attitude they're going with this game, and that's okay with me, but like, without giving too much away about the plot of Persona 3, it is very concrete in the canon of this series that the events that happen there happen with a boy with blue hair that stopped the end of the world. It's referenced in Persona 4, it's referenced in Persona 4 Arena, and as far as I can tell, she ain't a dude. Like, so does this confirm my hairbrain's Amala Network multiple reality theory correct, or am I grasping at straws? Who knows? But that's a little weird, Atlus. I don't know how they're going to explain that, but hey, maybe we'll get more details once we get closer to the game. Or maybe we won't get more details at all, and they'll just kind of hope we ignore years of canon. Who knows? But off the cuff, I just kind of want to talk about PQ. Not the most beloved game in Atlus's long history of releases. There are some fans of mostly the art style, but as far as like an actual game goes, it is a very polarizing experience. Some people hate it. Some people love it. Some people really, really hate it. And I'm kind of like, okay, I like it. I like what they were doing, but man, this needed a little bit more polish. And hopefully this sequel will be able to kind of be that polish. And you know, we'll have a more well-rounded game that doesn't make me want to pull my hair out. However, until we hear more about the gameplay and some of the changes that they're going to be implementing, it's really not the best to dissect it. All we know is this is probably going to be turn-based combat with some dungeon crawling thrown in. And hey, that makes me pretty excited. I really like to see what Atlus can do. Are they going to change up the persona fusing mechanic? Are they going to still allow us to have multiple persona on multiple characters? I think that was the coolest thing they did in the first Persona Q. If that stays intact, holy crud, that's gonna be awesome. But outside of that, this is all just wishful thinking. I think we are going to receive a weekly Famitsu through August 23rd, giving us more info, so I guess we'll go into more detail about the game when that arrives. But yeah, pretty goddamn excited for this. I mean, I'm just super pumped to see how Atlus plans to remix the game, what they're gonna change, what these new mysterious characters are all about, why is this dude so weird looking, like what? And all that stuff. But what do you guys think? Let me know in the comment section. I love to hear your theories about this weird duo. They're just so goddamn weird. He scares me. I don't know what it is, but are you pumped? Are you like, meh? Let me know. I'd love to hear it. And but yeah, thanks for watching, guys, and see you next time. Bye. This can't stand.